السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ووصينا الإنسان بوالديه إحسانا، حملته أمه كرها ووضعته كرها. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الأمين المكين الكريم، ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم صلاة وسلام عليك يا سيدي يا حبيبي يا رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم. All praise is due to Allah, the Creator, the Sustainer. Peace, blessings and salutations upon the greatest of His creation, Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, we are gathered here for the Jum'ah Salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our Jum'ah Salah with the congregation, inshaAllah. And may Allah guide us to perform our 5-time Salah with Jama'ah, inshaAllah. My fellow brothers in Islam, Alhamdulillah, I have been given this opportunity to pass a message from the Quran and the Hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And my short visit to the United Kingdom has given me an insight of the situation which we are facing. And the situation which I mean to say as the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And due to facing this situation, We are on a downfall. Why? Because it's not something which I am judging, but it is something from the Quran and the Hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if we understand this, then there are many who are not on the downhill; they are on the uphill. But the thing is, it's due to our negligence, because we are Muslims, Alhamdulillah, we are the followers of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, but we lack in such aspects which lead us to go downhill, to have a downfall. Nevertheless, there is a loan which each one of us here have got to pay back. Many of us might be thinking, I've never taken a loan in my life. And if I've borrowed it, I've made sure that I've paid it back. And how can I sit on this minbar and say that you have a loan? But let me tell you, this loan is such a loan that can never be paid back. It's a loan which never can be paid back. You can try all your life, but you will never be able to pay back that loan. What is that loan? What is that debt? And I'm telling you that every one of us here is in that debt. There's no one who will tell you that I'm not in this debt, because it's impossible. Unless you are a special servant of Allah and you don't have that debt on you. The debt is of your mother. The debt which you have and the loan which you have is of your mother. Why? Because the Quran mentions, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. And we have enjoined, we have commanded man to be good to his parents. Why? The Quran further mentions, حَمَلَتُهُ أُمُّهُ كُرْهَا. For she has carried, the mother has carried him with pain. وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهَا. And gave birth to him with pain. So that pain and that carrying and that time of labor is that time and debt and loan which we can never pay back.
Even if we serve our parents all our lives, we'll never pay back that loan, because that is such a debt upon us that we do not understand. But I will mention of my experience in the United Kingdom on a later stage. Let's look at the Quran. We will look at the ayahs of the Quran. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reminded us. So imagine that Allah is reminding you and me about this favor of which our mother has done upon us. We are, many of us are fathers here, many are grandfathers here. And if you just understand, if our spouses go through that, then we know that what our mothers have gone through, because that is in front of us. So you have to understand that when they go through that pain, there are certain acts which they do not do. Why? Because they feel my child is going to have some pain. If I am going to stretch high, my child will get hurt. If I am going to bend down, my child is going to get hurt. So she abstains from those things. Why? Because yes, she loves you so much. She loves us so much. So the Quran has shown us this favor that our mother has carried us and given birth to us with pain. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ. Now you must know the ibadah of Allah is being mentioned in this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ. The summary of this ayah is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us that we should worship no one but Allah. We should worship no one but Allah. Now, just mentioning of worship, you must know that we as Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah propagate this, that we do not worship anyone but Allah. Only one Allah. And we do not give the status of the Creator to any creation. But we believe in medium, we believe in wasila. But wasila, the person who we ask, does not make that person the creator. That's not our belief. We have to get this clear. But if we deny wasila, then I'm going to tell you from this minbar that if you go to the doctor, you're in a problem. Because Allah is the one who gives you shifa. Allah is the creator of man and woman. But how do we come into this dunya? If our creator is Allah, they are asbab, they are means of how we come into this dunya. So Allah has kept shifa. When we go to the doctor, we complain to the doctor as the doctor is going to give us shifa. Is he going to give us shifa? No. He's just the means. He's just the wasila. So the point is that we as the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, just to clarify, that we do not give the status of the creator to anyone. The creator is the creator. But in the creation, Allah has made means, Allah has made wasila for us to reach the creator. So nevertheless, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in chapter 15 of the Quran mentions, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us the command that we must worship no one but Allah. And just imagine, ibadah of Allah. And after the ibadah of Allah, what has Allah mentioned? وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And being good to your parents. After the ibadah of Allah. So imagine that after that great aspect and that great act of ibadah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions being good to our parents. So that is the significance. That is what we have to understand from the Quran and the teachings of the Quran. In another place in the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. And do not even say uff to them. Do not even say uff to them. And do not say hurtful words to them. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. The summary of these ayahs. When I say summary, that is including the tafsir and the explanation of that ayah. So, in that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning, and do not say hurtful words to them. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. And say good words to them. And say nice words to them.
Subhanallah.
Why? Why? Why should we? Referring back to the first ayah, remember that pain your mother went through. You can never ever pay that pain back. And that is the reason why the shair has mentioned ke khuda ne mujhe ko diya ma teri duaon se ma teri duaon se mila hai jo bhi mila ma teri duaon se ma teri duaon se ma ki dua jannat ki hawa 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 Maki dua. The dua of the mother. When the Prophet ﷺ has mentioned to us, but before I come to that, we've come in this masjid, being humble to Allah, we want to perform our ibadah. Tell me who is going to give me a guarantee that our ibadah is accepted. There's no one. I can't. You can't. We can't. But we make dua to Allah to accept our ibadah. Understand this point. That if we even go for Hajj, there is no guarantee of our ibadah being accepted. We go for Hajj. We lose our minds. We talk improperly. We return back. Some of us don't, some of us abstain, some of us control our temper, we come back. But we can't guarantee our Hajj is accepted. We give zakah, we do not know if Allah has accepted that zakah. We fast, we do not know if Allah has accepted our fasts. But this, understand all these pillars which I have mentioned of Islam. Zakah, Salah, Sawm, Hajj. Shahada is the first pillar, right? Besides that, four of the pillars are what we are to do in our daily lives. But Shahada is a very big topic and it needs a lot of time for elaboration. Nevertheless, any of these ibadah which we do in our life, there's no guarantee if it is accepted. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned that if you look at the face of your mother with love, you get the reward of an accepted Hajj. There's a guarantee. Your ibadah, your Hajj, the sawab of that Hajj is accepted just by looking at your mother with love. With love. The companions, Allahu Akbar, subhanallah. The Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked that, "What if I look at my mother 10 times in a day?" Subhanallah. There's no guarantee of any ibadah, but this is a guarantee. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replies that if you look at your mother 10 times, you get the reward of 10 accepted. But we do not treasure what we have, but when we do not have it, we want to have it. When we see someone else, we want to have it. Imagine, think of those orphans who've never had the love of their parents. Think of those who have lost their parents. Think of those people who have not been given that love. And we, having that opportunity, are depriving ourselves from it. When I will give you the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that will give us the final answer to tell us that why did he say that we are on the downhill, we are falling down. Why did he say that? Because there's one hadith which I will give you, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive any sin which we do. Allah can forgive any sin, but that does not mean that I am promoting yourselves to do sins. No. But if we ask for forgiveness, now, whilst mentioning of forgiveness, let me tell you the types of tawbah. You see, some of us think to ourselves that committing major sins, we ask Allah for maaf, and that's it. Our sins are forgiven. No. I'm not guaranteeing it. Maybe Allah could love the way you have asked. But the method, you see, there's minor sins, there's gunah saghira, and there is gunah kabira. Saghira sins are the minor sins, whilst kabira sins are the major sins. Now, the minor sins, there's a possibility. You see why? After we read salah, after any salah, we greet each other. From the hadith we learn that our sins are forgiven. These are minor sins. We learn on many aspects that if we read two rakat salah for the pleasure of Allah, Allah can forgive all our sins. Those are minor sins. But when it comes to major sins, your major sins are only forgiven if you are to take off. You have to say, Allah, I will never commit that sin again. Oh Allah, I will never commit that sin, and I make tawbah from that sin, and then you practice upon that. That is when Allah can forgive your major sins. That is gunah kabira. So, in those major sins, one of the major sins is disrespect to the parents. According to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, whilst mentioning this hadith, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could forgive any of these sins, but that doesn't mean, again, I'm emphasizing that I'm trying to lessen these sins compared to this. No. A sin is a sin. Guna is guna. But the Prophet ﷺ has said that Allah could forgive any sin, but there's one sin which you will not be forgiven for and you will be punished in this dunya. And that is the disrespect to your parents. Now you can judge yourself. You can think to yourself, that have I been good to my parents or have I not been good to my parents? Because if we have been good to our parents, then we know that what we have done is going to be good for us in this dunya. And if we have not been good to our parents, then accept the problems. Because you must know that how we have treated our parents, accept your children to be treating you in the same manner. Because if you have not been good to your parents, what goes around comes around, although it's not an Islamic saying, but it makes sense. That what goes around comes around, in the sense that the way we have treated our parents, we expect our children to be treating us, because that is what we have done in this dunya. Let me share you one story, and this story always brings tears to me, whether it's fiction or non-fiction, but just I read it from somewhere and I thought that this is really something which brought tears to my eye. There was a child studying in school. While studying in school, his mother was the staff member of that same school. And the mother would come and visit the child. Whenever she would get into the classroom, the children would start screaming. They would start laughing. And then this child would tell his mother that, "Go away! You're embarrassing me." You know what was the defect with the mother? She only had one eye. She only had one eye. And because she had one eye, the children would start laughing. Some would get scared. Some would scream. It used to be like an amusement. But the mother would still want to see the child. The mother still wants to see the child. Although being amused, although being hurt, she still goes into that classroom and she still wants to see the face of her child. The child works hard. He studies. He becomes something. And he goes abroad. Now, the mother still loves the child. One day she thinks to herself, "Let me go and visit my child. Let me go and visit my child. She goes. Now she's become a grandmother. Because that child has got children now. She goes and visits the son, and as soon as she enters the house, the son screams from there and says that you've embarrassed me in class, now you've come to scare my children as well. Go away! Mother goes away. Do you know what a sin it is to make our mother tear? The Quran has mentioned, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. That do not say hurtful words to them. Because the worst thing we can do is hurt someone's heart. If we are not able to do good, then let us make a target of making someone smile in a day. Just try and make someone happy in one day. Nevertheless, this mother goes away. But before she leaves this world, because now everyone has to go from this dunya, and we have to leave this world. So this mother also had to leave this world. And before she left this world, remember, she has what? She has one eye. She has one eye. And the child, who was actually the son of this mother, was chasing her away because people were getting scared because of that one eye. And she went and visited him when he was abroad, and he also chased her away again. But before she left this world, she left a message back and said, go tell my child this message. What was the message? The message was that when my child was born, he had one eye. When my child was born, he had one eye. I thought to myself that I have lived my life. I've had enough of this dunya. Let me give my eye to the child. She gave that eye to the child. And when she gave that eye to the child, that child had no defect, but he was chasing the mother away because of that same defect. So think to yourselves that today if our parents are living, we're supposed to treasure them. We're supposed to make the most of it. And when I mentioned that my experience in the United Kingdom is that we do not treasure our parents. And this is a general statement. This is a general statement. And I, wallah, I have cried when I've seen stories in these few days I've been here. And what I've heard, that my brothers in Islam, if I do not leave you this message, remember, the truth is always sour. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned that speak the truth, although it may be not right to the people or they don't like it. That's the summary of the hadith. So I have to tell you, I have to mention to you. And if we can rectify ourselves, then inshallah, Allah will reward me and Allah will reward you for doing that. My fellow brothers in Islam, today you have to understand that our mothers, have they committed a sin to carry us? If they have kept us in their wombs, have they committed a sin? Kya usmane gunah kiya hai ke humko pala? Did that mother do a sin to keep us, to keep, grow us up? To make sure that when we are young, we are staying away from all the bad people. When we are young, we do not do the wrong things. And when we cry in the night, she wakes up and stays up with us. Did she do a sin? Has she committed a crime? That she deserves to be living alone? She deserves to be in the old age homes, my fellow brother in Islam? You tell me. When I visited a brother, he said years back, I thought to myself that I should open an old age home. But I didn't because I would have encouraged the brothers. But today I regret. This is a person from the community. He tells me I regret. Because why? Look at it. What are we doing? It's like our mothers have done the biggest mistake to grow us up. And 18 years of our life, we have lived 19 years of our life, 22 years of our life, our mother and father take care of us. And then when we grow up and find the woman of our life, we take that same mother and father out of the house. We take them out of our house and we do not treat them properly because of that same woman who we have fallen in love with. And that mother who still loves us, who still cares for us, who did everything for us. And we forget all of that just in a split of a moment. We've become too big for our own shoes, my fellow brothers in Islam. The problem is, and I will support this from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there was a companion known as Alqama. I'm very sorry, but this is a very emotional topic. Why? Because look at ourselves. What are we doing today? We do not even care. I heard from the same member of the community that that old woman lives in a home alone. And when she lives in the house alone, she put left the cooker on and the house was on fire. Does she deserve that? Is that what you give her, pay her back for the same loan that yesterday I visited one person? It was very sad to me that what is happening today? What is the story today? What are we doing today? We do not understand that what is the respect of our mothers? What is the respect of our fathers today? My fellow brothers in Islam, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was a companion, Alqama, radiallahu anhu. And he was about to leave this world. And when he was about to leave this world, the companions tried to make him read the kalima. But he failed to read the kalima. When he failed to read the kalima, the companions got worried. And they went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they mentioned about this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, and when they inquired, they found out that his mother is alive. They called the mother. And they asked the mother regarding the son. And when they asked regarding the son, the mother replied that my son is so pious. He never misses his salah. He fulfills all the obligations. But there's just one problem. There's just one problem. That one problem is that he always put his wife before. He always put his wife before me. Now you must know that this is from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's not from Nabil's pocket. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam inquires from the mother regarding the son. And the son is failing to read the kalima. And this is a dua which all of us should be making, that, oh Allah, take me from this world with the kalima, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the companions that bring the firewood. Let's start creating a fire. So the mother asks, that are you going to put my son in there? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, yes, we are going to burn your son. She says, no. She says, don't burn my son. You must know that this mother is frustrated. This son has done all the ibadah in this life. And he has been a very good, pious person. But the only thing is that he puts his wife before his mother. And why do we face problems today? What is the problem today? In the United Kingdom or in the community or anywhere. I'm talking on a general aspect, my fellow brothers. This is not a message to anyone personally. But this is my responsibility, what I have seen. It is the truth, it might hurt, but we have to face it. Because if we do not, ask yourselves why you are destructing. Ask yourself why you are going towards destruction.
Ya Allah.
The mother says that do not burn my son. All of you be witness that I am forgiven my son.
Oh, subhanallah.
And then they go. They go to the son. And they now tell him to read the kalima. And he reads the kalima and leaves his world. So understand that being deprived from the kalima can be, one of the causes can be that we have caused pain to our parents. We have not been good to our parents. My fellow brothers in Islam, this is a very, very vast topic and we need a lot of time to discuss this. But inshallah, I will end my discourse just in a few minutes. We will catch up with the few minutes we go extra. Do not worry. I am also Maimon. So I will cover up your time. My fellow brothers in Islam, whilst our Imam Sahab has mentioned, I'll mention one more narration. One person falls in love with a woman. And that woman says, you make sure that you kill your mother. Imagine that we become so blind. We become so blind when it comes to marriage and woman that we forget that that mother is also a woman and she has given birth to us. She has carried us. The Quran mentioned that حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ كُرْهَا. I mentioned this earlier for the brothers who came late. That the Quran has mentioned the favor of the mother carrying us وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهَا and giving birth to us with pain. The Quran has mentioned. But this person has fallen so much in love that he makes sure that he has to kill his mother. But the woman keeps a condition that you make sure that you bring her heart to me. I want to see that yes, you have killed your mother. The person does so. He goes and kills his mother. He brings the heart. He's on his way to the woman who he's in love with. When he is walking, he trips and he falls. When he falls, the heart falls a distance away from the mother, from the person who has killed his mother. The boy who has killed his mother is carrying the heart and walking, and he trips and the heart falls away from him a small distance away. Do you know what happens? What happens is that heart asks that, are you okay, my son?
Allah.
Are you okay, my son?
Subhanallah.
How can we, you know, the thought of just my mother, alhamdulillah, she is alive. But just the thought of her leaving this world makes me worry. And I mentioned, I visited a few people. I'm not talking about their stories. I do not know what their stories are. But I'm trying to say that they are sick. They are not well. And looking at that situation is what I'm talking. I'm not talking about anyone's problems or anything direct. As I mentioned, this is a general topic which we are talking about. And we make dua that may Allah grant shifa to all those who are sick. My fellow brothers in Islam, imagine that that mother is killed. But the heart, when he trips, asks that, are you okay, my son? It is so easy. How many of us kiss our mother's hand? It is so easy to kiss our girlfriend's hand, which is not permissible in Islam. Yes, do not take it as permissible. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But this is a fact which I'm talking about. Yes, that it's so easy to do the haram sins, but it's so hard to kiss our mother's hand. The same mother who gave birth to us, my fellow brothers in Islam. And she did everything for us. The fathers might be thinking, ke hi to maa jo bole to, asanjo bhi ki hai ka nahi. Yes, you do have. There is. When I say parents, it takes mother and father. And you must know the father is the middle door to Jannah. And the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, ridallahi fi ridal walidi wa sakhtullahi fi sakhtil walidi. Aw kama qala alayhi salatu wassalam. That the pleasure of Allah is in the pleasure of your father, in the happiness of your father. And the anger of Allah is in the anger of your father. This is a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm sure you will want to take this home. Because you might want to pass it on. Because this is pani matlab ji ka hai. But nevertheless, the point is, my fellow brothers in Islam, coming to the end of my discourse, is that we need to treasure our parents. If they are living, serve them. We do not know how many years they've got left. They haven't committed a sin to bring us up. They have done what we deserve. Let us give them what they deserve. They brought us up. Imagine parents have gone through such a hard time that they make sure that they have fulfilled the education of the child. That child becomes a lawyer, child becomes an accountant, child becomes a doctor, whatever he becomes, whatever profession he goes for. And then that same child, after the parents have given so much of sacrifice to educate him, and then what happens? That same child chucks them out. That same child takes them out. Because they ask you 10 questions. What is this? What is that? That irritates you? That irritates us? Yes, but the problem is, when we were a child, we would say mom, mom, mom 10 times. We would ask our mother 10 times. We would ask our father, what is that? No, tell me, I forgot the name. What is that? Ukruai, what is that? Again and again. But never would our parents be upset with us. But when it comes to our sons, and we see that they are in the old age, then what do? We tend to take that as irritation. And then that same mother who gave birth to us, grew us up, becomes a headache. Why? Because the wife says, your mother is a pain. Your mother is a headache. And we accept it. That is us today as Muslims, my fellow brothers in Islam. That is us in the United Kingdom, and that is what I've seen. And that is my experience. I'm very sorry. I am very emotional in this topic because it's very hurtful. When you see old-aged people who are crying, have they done a sin to bring the children up? Have they done a sin to make sure that they gave everything to their child and today they suffer and they do not have what is good for them? My fellow brothers in Islam, remember that if our parents are living, give them the love. Imagine those who have not been given that love. Think of those who have not been blessed with that love. But Islam is for everyone. Islam is for everyone. If your parents have left this world, you can read Surah Yasin for them. And you can perform Hajj on behalf of them. And Allah will make you from those who have been good to the parents. But that doesn't mean kani halivan na to pachi karnas. No! You do not know whether it's accepted. You've got the actual chance of being good to them. My fellow brothers in Islam, let's not waste time. Let's treasure them. They've given us everything. They deserve the best. We have to make sure. I do not agree to this fact that, Mulana, you are from Malawi and the culture there is different. You know, parents, you can take care of them. Houses are small here. They never worried how small their room was. Yes. They never saw how small their room was. Yes. They never saw. Your heart has to be big. Yes. Yes. Your heart has to be big. If your heart is big, dil mein jagah hogi, to sab jagah pe jagah ho jayegi. Dil mein jagah rakhni chahiye. The culture is different. United Kingdom is different. Malawi is different. You people can keep your parents. You've got people who work for you. But your parents brought you up in the United Kingdom. They brought you up in United Kingdom. They had no maids. They cleaned your nappies, they cleaned your clothes, they washed your clothes, and today when they come to an old age, you tell me the culture is different? What's wrong with us? Why do we not look at the good culture which the government and the council teach us, that you need to take care of old age people, you need to take care of children? What is this? This is Islam, child benefit. This is Islam. When a widow, the benefit is Islam. All this is Islam. And we say culture is different, but our parents brought us up in this same country. My fellow brothers in Islam, I'll cover up for the time. I ask for forgiveness that I've taken a few minutes extra, but let us treasure our parents. I'm very sorry for being a little bit emotional, but this is a topic. This is a topic which we need to understand. And this is what I saw. My personal sight and what I saw in the United Kingdom. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me if I made any mistake during the translation of the ayah of the Quran, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the narrations of the incidents. I ask Allah to forgive me. I make tawbah for any mistake anywhere in my discourse. I ask Allah to take us from this world with the kalima, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is my principle whenever I deliver a lecture or speech or talk, then I end with the rule of Sharia. My fellow brothers in Islam, we are all busy, but there are 14 rakats in Jummah Salah. There's 4 sunnah, which is mu'akkada after the adhan, we will all read together. And then there is 2 farz, which we read with the imam. And then there is 4 sunnah, which is mu'akkada again, and then 2 sunnah, which is mu'akkada, and then there's 2 nafl, according to the Hanafi mazhab. There's 14 rakats. So, at least on the day of Jummah, on the blessed day of Eid,
we can make sure that we'll sacrifice elsewhere, but we'll fulfill these sunnah, which are those sunnah. Mu'akkada, when I say mu'akkada, are those sunnah which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not leave in his lifetime. So we, and leaving it deliberately, we are sinful. We are sinful for that. So let us try and assure that we fulfill these sunnah which are mu'akkada. The minimum which we can read in Jum'ah is 12. And 14, but there you can read Nawafil as much as you want, inshallah. And I request all of you here, inshallah, we will have one more session, but it won't be as emotional as this one. Do not worry. You might think he's Molana ke koi mic na diya hai, you know that. So don't worry. In the night, it won't be as emotional as this one. We will have a small naat program, and inshallah, I will explain a few knots and a small speech as well, inshallah. Ask Allah to forgive us all, inshallah. وَمَا تُوفِيقِ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَأَخِرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.